Hi, family. This is Pastor Park. Welcome to our Tuesday night prayer meeting. And in a few moments, you're going to see prayer requests. And these prayer requests, they're really important for us to really concentrate and be able to pray for. Many people are relying on us to pray and intercede on their behalf. So join us as we begin to pray. Thank you. Hi, welcome back. As always, if you need to talk to somebody to get counsel, or if you need to have someone pray with you, or just someone to talk with, you can call the church during Monday through Friday business hours, 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. at 718-290-2000, or you could email your prayer requests through the website. Now, I just came back from the Middle East, and we were working with our partners there and seeing our field workers, this family that we had sent out there. And it's just always a blessing. I always wish I could take you all with me to some of these locations so that you can see how you have impacted the world, whether through your prayers, but also through your giving. You've allowed and enabled people like Jamie and Sandra to serve in Lebanon, to serve the people, to serve the refugees. We've been able to provide support for literally thousands, if not tens of thousands of people, especially through the pandemic, through your giving. We have some 16 families that we oversee all throughout the world, Central America, South America, the Caribbean, Africa, Asia, the Middle East, and your giving has enabled them to serve and be God's hands extended, but also our hands extended. So thank you so much for all of your giving and your partnership in this way, as well as your prayers. Now you're going to see a video about our new system for giving, online giving. It's called Paycom. So God bless you as you give.
We are excited to announce our new giving platform, PushPay. With PushPay, you can easily give online or from your phone. To give online, go to our website at brooklyntabernacle.org and click on the giving button. If you're watching on YouTube, click on the giving link in the description. Simply enter your gift amount and frequency and your phone number. Then enter your payment details, confirm your gift amount, and you're done. To give from your phone, simply text the code BTGIVE to 77977 and click on the link to enter your payment information. Do you currently have a reoccurring gift scheduled in SecureGive? If so, please cancel and re-enter it in PushPay by June 30th. Thank you for your continued generosity and support of the Lord's work.
So last year in March, I was in the Middle East, a small team, and we were doing ministry there. Little did I know, or the whole world would know, that the whole world would shut down for so many months. We ended up having to cancel maybe 6-7 mission trips. But just last month, we felt comfortable enough, I had gotten vaccinated, to go back out to the Middle East as my first trip since the pandemic. And we had a tremendous time there, and I'm going to share an update on that. But it reminded me of some of the reasons for why we're doing missions. And if there are two scriptures that I point to talk about the motivation of missions, it will be these two that I'm about to share. The first is what we call the Great Commission. In Matthew chapter 28, verse 19, it says, "Therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit." Now, the nations here is not a nation state like we would think of it. Let's say the country of India. It's ethnos in the Greek. It's a people group. So India, which is one political entity, actually is made up of thousands of people groups. So let me just define that for you. It's the largest group within which the gospel can spread without encountering barriers of understanding or acceptance. And there are 17,442 people groups around the world. There are 200 plus political entities, but in those political states, you have 17,000 plus people groups. Now, within these people groups, we have what we would call the Christianized world, or the reached world, where the gospel is reasonably free to be spread. You have churches and so on. But the other half of the world is what we call the unreached world, or the unreached people groups. And let me define that for you. It is the people group among which there is no indigenous community of believing Christians with adequate numbers and resources to evangelize this people group without outside assistance. So it's the people group from which there's no local indigenous community of churches and believers that can adequately evangelize their own people group without the outside, which is the missionary. So you're talking about people groups where less than 2% have believers and churches in them. That number of the unreached people groups is 7,413. So 7,400 or so out of 17,000, you're talking 42% of all the known people groups are considered unreached, which means there's a lot of work to do when it comes to sharing the gospel. The second scripture that has really challenged me and motivated me, I look at it as like the left and the right hand of missions. It's called the Great Compassion. So the previous one most people know is the Great Commission, and some have called this scripture the Great Compassion. And that's found in Matthew chapter 25, verse 35 to 36. And it says, "For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me." So worldwide, I know we live in kind of an American bubble where we have a lot of prosperity here, relatively speaking. But if you look at the rest of the world, there are more than 1 billion people that live on less than $1.25 a day. So there's some 7 billion people in the world. 1/7 of the world lives on less than that. And there are almost 1 billion people who are chronically malnourished. So these are people who could barely get one meal a day on a regular basis. So that's the Great Compassion. This is why we do food programs or clothing drives. We just did a barrel drive recently. Why I've organized medical clinics. We've gone to some 16 countries just to do medical clinics. Why we go into the prisons to do Bible studies. And the stranger, to me, I look at that as the refugee. And so the last few years, we've been concentrating a lot on refugee ministry. So going back to the unreached, I'll just focus on one particular unreached group, and that larger group would be the Muslim world. You have 1.3 billion Muslims worldwide, and I've been involved in that ministry, the Middle East, since the inception, since 20 years ago. But more recently, there was a big crisis that was starting to happen in Syria. And it was starting to hit the news. This was 2011. I didn't fully understand the full scope of what was happening. I mean, I knew the news, but until I was in a neighboring country, I had brought a small medical team to work with a ministry that serves Iranians. So we were expecting Iranian refugees, and we did, we saw a lot. But we start to see Syrians and Kurds coming in who were fleeing from this war that was brewing and happening right next door. And that was the first time I started to understand the scope of what was happening in Syria. And you had now currently about 5.6 million people that have fled Syria. They've gone to Turkey and Iraq and Jordan, Lebanon, and about 5 million have been displaced internally. So they have fled from their homes inside Syria, but they had to move to another place in Syria. And just to focus on one country alone, Lebanon, 2 million people fled to Lebanon. And officially, I think it's actually 1.5 or something like that, but unofficially, it's about 2 million. And this country originally had 4 million in it. So you're talking an increase of almost 50% of a population of a country. The other thing that was happening was ISIS, the rise of ISIS, particularly in Iraq and in Syria. And in 2014, that rise started to cause millions of Iraqis to flee as well. So they ended up fleeing kind of in the same countries that the Syrians ended up fleeing to. So, you know, remembered whenever we talked about Syria with my other worker friends, and Syria was always one of the most closed countries on the planet. Very, very little fruit, a lot of resistance, and since the advent of Islam in the late 7th century, there's been very little inroads made with gospel in Syria. But what happened is that the war then caused all of these people to start fleeing all over the place, and the churches, the local churches in those countries, started to minister to the people. They started to give food, they started to give humanitarian aid, medical aid, and this started to open up the hearts of the people that were coming in, hearts that had normally been closed. They started to really seek out, what is this Christianity? What is Jesus? Because they started to see the active love of Christ in the people that were serving them, unconditionally, no strings attached. And so this created an openness. And meanwhile, they were fleeing from all the attacks that were caused by people of their own faith. So that caused many to start rejecting that way and seeking God through the believers that were starting to help the people. So I started to hear of hundreds and then thousands and then tens of thousands who were coming to faith. At the same time, we had a church member that was in Lebanon. And so I brought out a team there, and we went throughout the whole country doing medical ministry, ministering to the refugees, Syrians, Kurds, Iraqis. And again, we were just seeing this tremendous openness. The local churches were starting to really open up their doors and starting to minister in ways that they never imagined before. So I began to build relationships with these different ministries, like RCB or Heart for Lebanon and all these different tremendous churches and ministries that minister in that region. I started bringing medical teams into the area, to Turkey, Iraq, Jordan, and so forth. And again, we're just seeing all over this tremendous open door to a door that had been closed for more than 1,000 years, it seemed. So in this one country, we ended up launching 2 medical life centers. And we've been able to see now almost more than 6,000 patients that have come through. Vast majority are Syrian refugees. And I've listened to a lot of their testimonies and how they came to the Lord. You know, and this idea, whenever they encounter scriptures that say, love your enemies, like in Matthew chapter 5, that just, it shakes them in a great way. It makes them rethink, like, wait a minute, this really is the power of God, to love your enemies. And so we started to open up these centers, we started to do other ministry, and you're about to see a short testimony of one of our leaders that are there that we partnered with, and he's going to share a little bit about how we're able to use the Medical Life Center to share the gospel.
Our vision in this center to share all people, and we start in our Jerusalem to share people about Jesus. This is our ID. And the medical center make a facility, and they open many doors to make a like a bridge with the people, because the people same in this time, we cannot said come to tell you about Jesus. We have a need, and Jesus do like this. And Jesus feeds the people. And if someone need to hear what Jesus said, he stay. And the medical center give us a big chance to connect with people and to share about Jesus and about the mercy of Jesus, because in this situation, all the people search about mercy, about joy, about happy. And we share, and the people ask, why you do like this? Why you pay this money? Why you help the people? And it's a big chance to say, because we love Jesus, and Jesus said, to help the people physically and spiritually.
And now at the same time, we had a family in our church that I've been discipling for many, many years. They've been a part of our global missions ministry for years. They've been coming with me on trips, mostly to the Middle East, and they just had a heart for that part of the world. The husband, Jamie, his father is from that part of the world. And so they felt a call from the Lord to go out and serve. They have two small children, and it was a number of years of this process of the Lord working in them and shaping them and molding them to where we finally said, okay, you're going to go out here. So we partnered with a church, a local church. Jamie is a social worker by training, but now he co-leads the youth ministry in that church. And he also has a counseling background, so he also does counseling for the church. Sandra, the wife, she's a registered nurse, and she's been on, I don't even know how many trips with me, medical missions-wise, probably 10 different countries. We never keep track of these things. So when we opened up this medical life center there, she just naturally became a part of it, and so God is using her to just, again, share the love of Christ to the marginalized, to the Syrian refugee, the Iraqi refugee, but also migrant workers. And now the local Lebanese are coming into the clinics as well. So Sandra now is gonna just take you on a quick day in the life of the clinic and what she does within the clinic.
I absolutely love working here, and I love the people that I work with, and I love the people that we serve. So, hi! So this is usually the waiting area, and these are our lovely ladies, right? And so the patients will come up the stairs, and we usually have them waiting in here. During COVID, we had them waiting outside in order to social distance. So once they come in and they come through the waiting area through here, they come through here, and they are greeted by our lovely secretary, Aisha and Zakia. And so we usually do the questions, you know, have you, especially during COVID, you know, we take temperatures. Aisha will take the temperature,
yes.
And then we'll ask, do you have cough, night sweats, diarrhea,
corona,
wash a ras, diarrhea.
Yes.
Yeah? Okay. So once Aisha has done the corona questions, we bring them in, and I usually have the patient sit here. And here I do vital signs, you know, blood pressure. If they're diabetic, I do their blood sugar. We do height and weight, and then we ask the questions, have you ever had surgery previously? Do you have any allergies to any food or medication? Allergies, are you currently taking any medication? You know, do you smoke? How much do you smoke? And I do my little bit here about if you smoke, you shouldn't be smoking. And then from here, we're filling out the charts, and usually Zakia sits behind the desk, and Zakia handles all the administrative stuff. She does the charts, and once the patient has been triaged, so they'll usually sit here and wait their turns. We socially distance, so we don't allow too many people in here at one time. And then from there, once the patient has checked in and they've paid their fees, and they come into one of either room.
The room on the right.
I'm sorry?
The room on the right.
The room on the right, okay. And they'll come in, they'll be seen in here by the physician. Once the patient has been seen by the physician, they usually come back out, and from there, Aisha and Zakia will direct them to whether they have to go to the pharmacy or have their lab work done, because the doctor gives them a form, and the form they take to the front desk, and then from there, they're directed on what they have to do. And that is what it's like here at Al Shafi Clinic. Best place to work.
So now, on my trip, I ended up going to the north, to the west, actually literally east, west, north, and south of the country, and met with many leaders, and also sat down and interviewed many different refugees who are patients of our clinics or beneficiaries of the food and hygiene care packages that we've been able to send them. And Lebanon's going through a unique crisis right now. They have a major economic and political crisis where the value of their local currency, which is the lira, has just completely collapsed. And this has caused tremendous hardship, not just for the refugees, but for the Lebanese now as well. Then you had the pandemic, which has caused all these lockdowns. And one of the doctors told me easily more than 50% of the population has had COVID. And they've had some thousands of deaths as well. But the lockdowns caused many to lose their jobs. A lot of businesses went out of business. In fact, as we were traveling around, there were some places that I knew that we would go to, they were closed. There was a place to eat that normally you'd need reservations for, and when we went, there maybe were only one or two other tables that were being used. So it was very sobering, and also just to hear the testimonies of some of the people and what they've been going through because of the lockdowns. And then on top of that, the third crisis was in August of last year. The port in Beirut exploded and was destroyed, and 85% of the products in Lebanon are imported, and the vast majority come through that port. And for some, it was just like the last straw. And now professionals have been leaving in droves and trying to get out, and someone told me that 50,000 professionals have left the country already, and many are still trying to get out. Some of the leaders, like one of the doctors that we have, really touched me. They really want to stay and minister to their people in this time of crisis. Actually, that makes me think of Jamie and Sandra, how they were trying desperately to get in, and all these people were desperately trying to get out to go where Jamie and Sandra were from. You know, so many trying to come to the States, and it was a testimony. It's like, no, you know, the Lord has called us here, and that really allowed these open doors for them to be able to share the love of Jesus with so many people. So these crises, you know, there's a CNN view of the world, which is just destruction, and it's terrible, and calamity, and suffering, and all those are true. But behind the scenes, or around the scenes, however you want to put it, so often God uses these crises and disasters to shake people and their foundations, to make them wake up. If your security is anything in this world, you're on sinking sand. And so it's caused so many people to question their security and then look to eternity, to look to the Lord. And so I always look at these things in those two lenses. The tragedy is real, and we're doing our best to try to minister to people in that tragedy. But at the same time, you know, this earth, this life is not the end. There's eternity. So this gives us this opportunity to be able to share the eternal gospel, the eternal good news, that this is not the end. So these crises that's happening, it's very real, and many are suffering. But then I was hearing all these different testimonies of Muslims who became believers, and just sharing how this was the truth. They no longer cared about the material things. Even if they were not able to receive anything, the fact that they received Jesus, that's really ultimately all that truly mattered. So I was very touched and blessed by that. And we as a church, we have been able to help. Just in Lebanon alone, we've been able to distribute about 50,000 food and care hygiene packages to thousands of families. These would last more than a month. And with the collapse of the currency, it actually goes even further now. So we've been able to do a lot of ministry through this crisis. And I wanted you to hear from one of the refugees who agreed to share her testimony a bit, and just share how the situation has affected her, and how she was able to be blessed by our partners. And then after her, you'll hear from another ministry leader who we worked with, who helped with the temporary housing of people who lost their homes in the explosion. Some, I think it was 300,000 people lost their homes some for a couple of weeks, some basically permanently. They had to find completely new housing. So this partner was able to help with that. They also helped with some of the rebuilding of and repair of some of the homes. So why don't you watch these testimonies and be blessed.
صار لي 6 شهور بالكنيسة الأيامي ومتشكرة كثير على الدعم وعم يعطونا غذائية كل شهر عم نجي ناخد الحمد لله عم يكفينا بنشكر كثير الكنيسة الأيامي رح نداوم فيها على طول إن شاء الله بإذن الله كان صعب كثير وفيها خوف وحفظنا على حالنا قد ما فينا نعقم حالنا وكل ما نطلع نلبس كمام يعني صارت صعبة صارت بتخوف صرنا نعتني بحالنا أكثر لا جوزي صار له سنة قاعد بلا شغل كنا قاعدين مطرح الانفجار صار انفجار صرنا هلا انتقلنا على مطرح ثاني الايجار علينا كثير كان فينا ندفع ايجار جوزي صار له 6 اشهر قاعد صار له سنه ساعدونا كثير صار في فائده مثلا احنا ما نشتري كل غرض مثلا القطعه ب 10,000 صرنا ناخذ من الكنيسه ببلاش يعني بتكفينا كل نهار نطبخ طبخه تكون من الحصص الغذائيه من الكنيسه اللي عم ناخذها مواد تنظيف كله متشكر كثير الكنيسه
Hi, my name is Eli Haddad. I'm the president of the Arab Baptist Theological Seminary serving in Beirut, Lebanon. We're a seminary that equips leaders for the church and the entire Arab world, Middle East and North Africa. We are very grateful for our partners who have come alongside us, especially at the time of the Beirut explosion, where we were able to care for so many people and families. So this is a special thank you for you for coming alongside us. And doing this. When the explosion happened in August 2019, our student had already gone home, so we had a lot of empty space at ABTS. We didn't stop and ask God what to do. It was the most natural thing to do, that we have space, people have become homeless, that we open up our facilities. We didn't even think about funding, so we opened up the space and people came in. They needed care and health-wise and socially, mentally, physically, spiritually, everything. And you know, the explosion came after pandemic and after an extreme economic spiraling down of our economy in Lebanon, banking sector and hyperinflation. So people were not doing well to start with, and suddenly with the explosion, everything collapsed. So there was a lot to be done with these families. So we started to receive a lot of funds from our partners. We were able to care for everyone that stayed at ABTS. We had around 85 people stay at ABTS. We helped them get settled back into their own homes or rent new homes if their homes were beyond repair and put new appliances and things that are necessary for their livelihood. In addition to that, we were able to work with about 300 families and groups of small children that were impacted by the explosion. So we were able to work not only through the system at ABTS and the staff, but also through our church connections. So through church groups, they were able to, we partner with them so they would care for the families spiritually and socially and physically, and we would support the repairing of their homes or resettling in new homes. So we were able to impact more than 300 families and groups of small children that were traumatized by the explosion. The story to tell, the amazing story to tell, is the role that the local churches have played in the middle of this. It was an amazing sight to see the churches in Lebanon being transformed. I grew up in Lebanon going to church. I grew up during the civil war, and the church was very much silent and minding its own business. Today, during the explosion, the church experienced something totally new. The church found itself on the streets of Beirut, sweeping and cleaning and repairing and healing and feeding and giving water and praying and preaching the gospel in word and in deed. So to see in the middle of the darkness that we experience in Lebanon, that God was doing what he does best, redeeming a bad situation, and life is coming out of it through his church, empowered by the global church. And we're in the middle of all of this. So it's an amazing sight to see. A lot of hopelessness, and God provides a message of hope through his church, which is the agent of hope. Thank you for being part of what God's doing in our region. A special thank you to you, Brooklyn Tabernacle, for coming alongside us and empowering us and enabling us to care for all of these families.
I hope you were blessed to hear some of those testimonies and to just see a small snapshot of what's happening in the Middle East. I mean, it's just the tip of the iceberg. We're meeting with so many different people and so many wonderful testimonies that's happening out there. But I wanted you to be able to see that for yourself and to see where our partnership, our giving, and our field workers that are out there, what they've been able to do, especially during the pandemic. So I want to spend the next few minutes in prayer for the Middle East, for the unreached, for the Muslim world, that we could pray that the Lord would start to open up the hearts of those, especially who are the most closed, especially the militants, those who are like the really like the Saul in the book of Acts, that God would turn them into Pauls. And that's been happening. I've met them myself, and it's been a tremendous testimony. But we want to see more and more coming to the faith. And also just to bless the, pray for blessing for the churches and the field workers and the ministries that are out in the Middle East. It's not easy. You're in the minority, and there's a lot of persecution and hostility towards believers, even despite what they're trying to do for the people. So let's pray that God would bless them physically, materially, spiritually, emotionally, in all these different ways. In fact, many have expressed some burnout because there's so many, like thousands and thousands that people are ministering to, and that's a real concern that I, as a pastor, I was feeling that as well. So join me in prayer for the Middle East, for the unreached, for the field workers, the churches, the ministries, and for God to really open up the hearts of many, many more so that they would come to know Him and receive the Lord as their Savior. God bless you as you pray.